All right, big news. As you may have seen on the poster on the way in, there's a poster on the wall in the, we used to call it the narthex in the foyer in the front there. We are doing a photo directory, and I want first, if we can say thanks to Dee, because she's putting this together for us. And Dee is your contact. Wave your hands in the air like you just don't care. There we go. So Dee is going to basically put this together for us. There's a few things that you can do. I know this is a perfect time. Amy and I have been talking for about 2 years now about the need for us to get a family portrait. So this is going to be an opportunity for us to get a family portrait as well. But it's free. Okay, so you get one portrait for free. You get a photo directory for free. All you have to do is come in and sign up to have your photo taken. Is the book going to be out there or should they come? Okay, the book's going to... You have to book it in? Okay, so speak to Dee if you want to get yourself booked in. I know she's going to speak to you, so just so we're aware. And also, if you could do us a huge favor, if you are new here, or you haven't, if you're not new, yet you haven't filled out one of these forms, it's either in the pew or the chairs in front of you or behind you, you'll see that form, and it gives us your name, your address, contact. You can put birthdays and anniversaries. We have a card sending ministry, so we love to keep in touch with you then. But basically, if you want more information about our church, you can check it. If you want a mail folder so we can keep you in the loop, offering envelopes, or visit from our pastor, which means a visit from the lovely Amy, then you can make sure that you fill that out. So that will help us as well, though, when we're doing the photo directory. So please make sure that we have all that information. You can just put it in with your offering, and we'll make sure it goes to the right spot. Did I miss anything, Dee? If your contact information has changed, I'm saying it again just for YouTube, if your contact information has changed since the last time we did a directory, we also need to know as well. Okay, perfect. That's our first announcement. Second announcement is Monday at 10:30. Tomorrow is Kingdom Prayer Time here at the church. We had a great group out a couple of weeks ago. We didn't do it because of the holiday this week, but almost two weeks ago, we had a wonderful group out. We sing some worship songs together. We share what's going on in each other's lives. We pray for you, anything that comes up that's going on in your life. We pray for the church. This is part of the lifeblood of our church. I'm going to talk about my sermon, is prayer. And there's a lot of prayer warriors here. We would love to have you come out to that 10:30 tomorrow. Third announcement is Sunday school. We are looking for a ministry opportunity for anybody who wants to help. We've had a couple of volunteers come forward already. Amy's going to be touching base with them. We do have a Sunday school. For those little ones who are here, Amy's taking you outside for something special today, so that's going to be a lot of fun. So if you're interested, please speak to Amy about that. We're doing Pray for Hallie. Meet at the train beside the school on August 27th. This is being arranged by Youth Unlimited. Also, I want to use this as an opportunity to call you to pray for Youth Unlimited. They're going through a whole needs assessment, a whole assessment of where they're going to go as far as their ministry. It's been an amazing ministry here in Halliburton for years, and I know a lot of the churches have supported that. So just continue, and maybe coming together to pray for Hallie would be good. Finally, there are Bibles available at the back of the church if you're interested. They're the blue ones just on the pew back there beside all the kids' sheets that we have back there, the coloring sheets. That is a gift. If you don't have your own Bible, that is a gift from Amy and I to you. So please take one. Someone mentioned they're pretty small print, so just so you know, there's large print ones on the way. I spoke with Kathy at Masters, and we're gonna make sure that happens. All right, our call to worship is from 1 Chronicles 16, 28 to 31. We're going to take a moment just to remember the Lord is in our midst, to invite the Holy Spirit to make his presence known to us. Come, Holy Spirit. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. And let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Amen. I'm going to invite the worship team to come forward, and Amy's going to lead us in some congregational prayers.
Let's pray together. Lord, Lord, what an honor it is to be in your presence and to be with your family and within your body. And Lord, we just welcome you in our midst. And Lord, we pray for this family and for this body. There are parts of us that are hurting. Some of us are grieving, Lord. Some of us are healing. Some of us are sick. And Lord, we just invite you into every one of those situations. We just take a moment and feel free to either silently or aloud offer up names that you would like to pray for. Lord Jesus, you know all of our needs. You know our wants. You know our hopes. And we just place ourselves in your hands, Lord, knowing and trusting that you know what's best for us and that you can grow beautiful things out of the ugliest mire. And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for that. God, we pray for our community. We pray for our government. We pray for global leaders. Lord, we just ask for your mercy and your guidance. Lord, we pray for this church. We pray for Shaun as he speaks for us today, God, and just ask that you would speak through him. And in all things, Lord, we offer you our thanks. Our thanks for your goodness, for your lordship, that you are a good king, and we worship you, Lord. In your name we pray these things. Amen. All right, let's stand together and sing. Is my mic on still? Did I lose my... Oh, there it is again. It's kind of... My mic's kind of kicking in and out, I think, a little bit. But let's sing 10,000 Reasons.
Worship his holy name. Sing like Crown in the Lord of peace.
And kids, if you want to follow me out through this door where Shaun is standing, we'll go outside together.
Ready to go there. You now have some homework to go look up what the potentate means. I love those hymns. Crown him with many crowns. I didn't know they were going to do that. That's one of my favorite hymns. So wonderful worship this morning. Let's pray. Loving God, your word is truth. It's living, it's active, it changes lives. And so we pray, Lord God, that your spirit would infuse your word this morning. That you'd speak to our hearts, Lord, in our thoughts and in our minds. And that only the truth would be spoken, Lord God, and especially only the truth would be heard. And that truth is Jesus. In your holy name we pray. Amen. How many people here have ever been in a race before? Been in a race, running race? Anybody kind of a walking race? You know, the fun runs that we do? Back before my back injury, I started to get worse. I used to do some races. And not very good, but I completed them anyways. And there's a certain mood when you're in a race that hits you when you first start. And it doesn't matter how much you've practiced, you almost always start out fast, especially if there's people there watching, right? You're all excited. Remember for the Army run, we'd all get together and we're all excited. They have us in corrals. And then the thing goes and the first corral group goes and then it's your group's turn and you're pumped and you're going and the juices are flowing, a little bit of adrenaline's going. But you get about, I don't know, half kilometer past the crowds. And you start realizing you're not Usain Bolt. You know, and it kind of hits you, and you're like, okay, I'm going to slow down just a second here. I'm going to get a breather, remember who I am, and I'm going to find my real pace. And then you find that pace after taking a breather, and you're able to kind of carry on. I read someone this week who compared the start of Acts. We've been going through the book of Acts to that, to the start of a race. And it's kind of, we've launched out of the starting gate. With our in Acts, as we started preaching on this through July, Jesus has been resurrected and he's teaching the disciples for 40 days. Then he takes them to the top of a mountain and then he disappears before their eyes up into the clouds. And then all of a sudden they come down the hill and they're in Jerusalem and Pentecost hits and there's fire, like their hair looks like it's on fire and the Holy Spirit has them speaking in other languages. And then all of a sudden, they're at the temple. We believe they're at the temple. And Peter is preaching the very first gospel message to the people. And like 3,000 people come to faith. So it's just been like right out of the gate, you know, hold on to your seats, church, because these things are happening. But now, at this point, the narrative is going to slow down where we are in our Bible. If you want to turn to Acts 2, 42 to 47, that's what I'm going to be preaching on. And the narrative takes a breather, okay? It's past the crowds now, and the narrative's kind of taking a breather. It's giving us a break, and it's going to set to the everyday work of building the church. We're continuing our Acts series. I'm going to read 2:42 to 47. I'm actually going to start at verse 36, just to give us some context. You'll see why as I'm reading. It kind of gives us some context that leads us into verse 42. So please listen to God's word. I'm reading from the ESV. Acts 2, starting at the 36th verse. Let all the house of Israel therefore know, this is Peter speaking, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him, Jesus, both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they, the crowd, heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter, the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. Think about that. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as they had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. Thank you, Lord God, for your lovely word. So if we see from verses 36 to 41 that I read there, the context that we get our passage, starting at verse 42, is that Peter has just finished preaching, and 3,000 souls from across both empires, the Parthenian, we talked about that last time, and the Roman Empire. We always think, oh, just the Roman Empire, but the people that they're speaking to and who are in Jerusalem at that time are from both empires. So it's from across the ancient world. That is who has been added to the number, 3,000 souls, not just people from Jerusalem. And at Pentecost, after the Holy Spirit had fallen on the disciples, it says they spilled out into the street and then they spoke to 3,000 people. Now, pretty much the only place in Jerusalem where you're going to speak to that many people is in the court of the temple. Okay, so we are pretty sure, like 99.9% sure, the disciples after Pentecost spilled down out of the upper room and they were praising God, and everybody in the streets on the way were hearing them speak in their own language, and then they went into the courts, not to the main temple, but into the courts, and that's where Peter stood up and he preached this wonderful message that he had, and that's where all the devout people would be. And we see after this big moment where Peter has presented the gospel and people are cut to the heart, and 3,000 people are added to their number. And this is the point. Immediately after that, the community of believers forms. If we look at verse 42, and they devoted themselves. What do they do after all this happens? What do? They devote themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. It cannot be overstated, friends, how important the church is to spiritual growth. Into growing in Christ. It cannot be overstated. There's a Baptist theologian named Stanley Grenz. He's a Canadian CBOQ guy, and he added, he basically added so much to Baptist theology. He's just an amazing author, used to teach out in BC. And he said this: nowhere in the Bible is there even the concept of a Christian apart from the family of God. The church is central to our sanctification. Of course, not the building, but the believers, our fellow believers coming together and being the church. There's something about that that God has caused to be a means of his grace for our growth. So 3,000, the first wave of believers, the first thing the apostles do, they set to building the community of faith. And from that is where we get what is traditionally called the four marks of the church. Okay, right from the start, these were the four marks of the church: teaching, fellowship, the breaking of bread, worship, and prayers. And so that's where I want to park, and I want to focus on. I often get the question, and I have for years, when people hear that I'm a pastor, or even when I was a chaplain, what do you do? Like, do you just work on Sunday? And my answer now is, well, I'm halftime, so I just work half of Sunday. And it kind of, I get maybe a chuckle like that because it's really only funny to me, but that is what it is. You make your fun where you can get it. But really, I think the confusion isn't about what the pastor does. The confusion in that question is, what does the church do? Like, what do we do as a church? And what is God calling us to do? God calls us to a lot of things, but right from the beginning, these were the four marks, what the church does: teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayers. Back when I was a kid, I was a member of the Beaver Scouts. Anybody here remember the Beaver Scouts or have kids that were members? Peterborough. I was a member of the Beaver Scouts, United Church in Peterborough, up in the North End. And one of the telltale signs of a they've changed it now, like they've changed everything, but one of the telltale signs was the scarf. That was a mark, the mark that, you know, you were very proud to have gotten your scarf. You had to tie it a certain way there. Your mom made sure that it was even on either side before you went. It was the mark that marked you as a Beaver Scout. It was unique. And so these, if we go to the next slide, these are the four marks of the church. These mark us as the community of God. And so I want to look and just kind of go through these. So first, we have gospel-centered teaching. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. The Bible makes it clear we need constant immersion in God's Word. But not just God's Word. We need constant immersion in God's Word together. I can't just be studying back in my room back there. I need to be sharing the Word. I need to be challenged. And I need to be growing in the Word together with you, with my church. Jesus' own commission to us from Matthew 28, taking us to the next slide, mission to us, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. This is, I grew up in a blue-collar family, okay? Meat and potatoes were the thing, right? Maybe we'd have noodles, but usually, and maybe a vegetable, but usually it was meat and potatoes. That was just kind of the basic thing that we grew up on, the basic staple. Gospel-centered teaching is mentioned first. That's the meat and the potatoes of being a church. If you're not teaching the Bible, you're not doing church. It's very simple. Without constant immersion in God's Word together, we will revert to the cultural mindset around us. I can really tell when Amy and I aren't actively engaged with our kids enough. Because they're on YouTube, getting immersed in the stuff they see on YouTube. And they're at school, immersed in what the kids are telling them at school. And I haven't been giving them the time the Lord says that I need to be giving them as pastor dad. Every dad in here and grandfather is pastor dad and pastor granddad, by the way. If I'm not giving them enough time, I'm allowing them to be immersed in something else. And you can really tell with kids when that happens. The same with us. We need to be immersed in God's word together. Because if we're not, YouTube and our social circle, that's what's going to start defining us and who we are. And that takes us to the second point. Likewise, without fellowship, we become isolated very easily. And so when the Bible talks about fellowship, it's talking about intentional, deeper relationships with fellow Christians. This is a meme that a friend of mine posted I told him I was going to steal it, from Redwater Alliance Church. He's a former Army guy, too, so when you see stuff that comes from him, if this is basically what it looks like. It's if I'm a Christian but I don't need the church was a photo, that's pretty much what you would look like. The herd's safe, and the world is picking off the one person who's not in and amongst the church. And so when we talk about teaching, again, it's not just teaching, it's teaching together. There's an accountability in the wisdom of the saints. One of the gifts of Baptists to theology is what we call community hermeneutic. And basically, community hermeneutic says, it starts with the Bible. The Bible itself, if we were to look at the Bible was written to who? Communities of people. If you look through Paul's letters, they are written to entire churches, not individuals. Even Acts, that's written to Theophilus, is written so that he will share it with the people, probably of Rome, where he was, amongst the middle class within Rome. The Bible itself was written to communities of people, not to individuals. And so what the community hermeneutic says, this theology says, because of that, the only way to truly understand the Bible is in community, is when we unpack it together. Yeah, there's times, and we've talked about this, where I'm studying God's Word myself, but just as important to that is studying God's Word and being involved in fellowship and growing together in God's Word and in the Bible. Community hermeneutic. And I have to tell you, online, friends, is very, very easy. It's easy. We went through an emergency time where online served its purpose, and we had to be separated. The Puritans went through times similar to what we just went through with the pandemic. And it's very easy, but I got to tell you, Amy will tell you, it was hard prying me off that couch when things started to open up. We were helping to plant a church, and I was like, well, maybe we just watch church online. And Amy's like, no, that's not, because I wasn't leading things at the time. We were just part of it. She's like, nope, you got to come with me. And that's where maybe I failed in my leadership role, and Amy really excelled at hers, and she peeled Shaun off the couch, and we started going to church again. Online, friends, it's a great addition. There's some great stuff online. There's some great stuff in books. Online is a great addition, but when it comes down to it, in the long run, online is not a substitute for true fellowship with other believers and true presence. I want to, for example, our friends here who are going to be watching this at the Gardens, again, our friends at the Gardens who are members of our congregation, we feel, we're praying for you, and we remember that you're watching. You know, our friends at the Gardens who are watching there, they're not beamed, it's not beamed out to their individual rooms. They're brought together, right, in the Gardens. They watch together because they know there's something about worship together that's important. That God inhabits the praises of his people. Being at the front here, hearing you praise, friends, ministered to my heart. I sometimes, there's been some Sundays where I've had to take a second to compose myself before coming up here to preach because your worship speaks to my heart of the presence of God. There's something about praise together of the Lord. Fellowship is a central mark of the church from the start, characterized by joy, characterized by hospitality and generosity. That takes us to our next one. They devote themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, and to the breaking of the bread. This first basically refers to communion. Okay, we're going to celebrate communion this morning, like we're celebrating today, setting the death and resurrection of Jesus at the center of our worship. That's the center of our worship. The church worships, and basically when we talk about they devoted themselves to the breaking of the bread, it's saying the church worships, and when the church worships, the salvation story of Jesus Christ is at the center of that worship, and the fellowship and the breaking of the bread. But there was also, so there was the symbolic meal of communion, but we also believe, and we also, the Bible tends to tell us that there was also a fellowship meal that actually went along with communion at that time. So in the early church, they would do communion, like I could, you know, when we're going to do the bread and we're going to do the cup here, but then they'd sit down together and they would have a fellowship meal. So that's why you have Paul, and what's the passage that Paul does that? 1 Corinthians 11, when Paul tells all the rich Corinthians, don't eat all the food before everybody else gets there, it's because he was talking about this fellowship meal. They'd do communion together, but then they'd sit down and they would have a meal together. I have a friend who has a PhD in philosophy. He was a philosophy professor at the time. And when we were living in Muskoka, he came to visit us once. And he was just passing through. I think he was planning on stopping, and he was loading up for a camping trip that he was going to do. And on his way through Muskoka, he was going to come visit us. And there was a McDonald's in the Walmart that he was stopping at. So I said to him, you know, why don't I just meet you at McDonald's? You know, so you don't have to go so out of your way. And he's like, oh, no, I don't eat at stores. And he explained to me, I thought that was kind of weird. So he came over and he explained when he came over, he said, listen, all this study of the ancient world has taught me that there is a spiritual, psychological link that eating somewhere creates with that space. If you eat somewhere, there is like this psychological, some cultures even believe, like universally believe, there's a spiritual link that you create with that place. And he says, universal understanding across cultures, he said, listen, Shaun, I am not about to build a strong spiritual link with Walmart or with Home Depot or Costco. So he would not eat in stores. That's how we're wired by God. It's understood across all of the different cultures. Eating together creates a spiritual bond. It creates fellowship. I know that there used to be a monthly meal here. I've had a number of people ask me, when are we going to start the monthly meal? Because it's important. You know, I think you intrinsically know that eating together builds community. Breaking bread together builds community. For me, practically, I think I slow down. You know, when I have something in my mouth, it means I can't talk. And maybe I have to listen to someone else. It's wonderful. Gives you a chance to speak. A church worships with Jesus at the center, friends, and it shares meals with one another. We share the communion meal, which focuses on Jesus, but also we share. So when you have each other over, your fellow Christians, you're doing church, a part of what it is when we're church. So I just want to invite you to do that. You know, you don't need us, you don't need the deacons, you don't need me to give you permission. Just have each other over and let's start fellowshipping with each other. once again. And that takes us to the final one, the big one again, prayer. And I know they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to the prayers. It would have been the Jewish prayers at that time, but also personal prayer. I've spoken a lot on prayer since I touched down in July. I know, so I'm not going to go into great detail, just to point you to the YouTube videos that are still up of those sermons. But I will say this, as a church, one of the things prayer does for us, and what it would have done for the ancient Jew, basically, prayer keeps us heavenly-minded as a congregation when it's at our center. You've probably heard the saying, you're so heavenly-minded that you're no earthly good. That's wrong. I think for the church, it's the other way around. We can become so earthly-minded that we're no heavenly good. And when we have prayer at our root and we're a people of prayer, it keeps our minds in heaven. Friends, we need to remember two things. First of all, Christ has made us citizens of heaven. You are a citizen of heaven, according to Philippians 3. That means we are resident aliens here. We are ambassadors of our real citizenship, which is in heaven. Now, I've worked as an ambassador overseas. I've worked as an ambassador in an ambassador sort of role in Ottawa. And the one of the things you need to keep in mind when you're an ambassador is who you are and why you're there. You're not there to get too involved in the politics on the ground. You're there to represent the one who sent you. Our citizenship is in heaven. And when we pray together as a church, we remind ourselves of that, and we stay heavenly-minded. As a community, an important aspect of prayer, it keeps our minds and our focus on what we are about. The first thing this first group of believers did was build a community marked by four things: teaching, fellowship, the breaking of bread, worship, and their worship together, and prayer. And the community that developed was powerful. Verse 43, and awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. Awe fell on everyone from the mighty acts of the apostles that they were doing, but also the nature of this new community. So when we look at this as West Guilford Baptist Church in the year of today, all right, that just kind of looks like doing church. Like, okay, yeah, that's doing church. But if we were the ancient Jew and we were looking at that, that's mind-blowing. And what was going on in front of them at that time was mind-blowing. To someone who was not a religious elite, the average ancient Jew couldn't go into the temple, certainly couldn't go into the Holy of Holies. They were stuck out here on the edges. And the Gentiles, they weren't even allowed like into the anywhere near that at all. They were even further back. They were used to being removed from the presence of God. The average unwashed person had to be removed from the presence of God. Only the priests were actually able to penetrate the innermost areas of the temple where the presence of God was. But here's this community of faith, right? So you're used to that. Then all of a sudden, you're with this community of faith, and the presence of God is working right there in front of you. It's happening right there. You've been made a priest, just like that. And you are in the inner Holy of Holies. The glory of God fell. He's showing himself. An awesome, mind-blowing experience. The God who is near. Not pushing you out. The God who is near, God who is personal. Is our faith personal? Is God personal for us? He wants to be. He wants to be. And the rest of the passage is an outward expression of all these things, of being a family together, of the joy and the hospitality and the generosity that came out. I just want to make a quick note on verses 44 and 45. They're a little bit misunderstood, okay? So I'm going to read through them. All who believed together had all things in common, and they were selling all their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as they had need. All right, so this is not an early form of a communist church. Okay, I've heard that actually. That's one hermeneutics that I've heard out of this, that this is some sort of, a couple of points about it. The sale of property isn't compelled by the government or the church, right? They're not being compelled to do that. We're not going to ask you to go sell your field and give us the money for it. This was a voluntary act of worship on the part of the people. But also, we see throughout Acts, people still had homes and possessions after this. They still owned things. They were selling extra property. Okay, so the Christians at that time would have owned property around the temple. What they were selling, though, was extra property. And it's actually, when they were selling extra property, it was still very, very significant what it was that they were selling. In the ancient world, families didn't let go of property. Like, you held on to your property. They held on to properties over generations. So while they weren't selling everything to live in a commune, what they were selling to support the church and to support fellow believers were things of consequence. They were selling their ancestral heritage because their new ancestral heritage was in heaven. Being a member of the family of God cost them, but in an active, spirit-led church, the cost is joy. If we read that passage, everything after that, this is all a joy. It's their joyous hearts that are causing this. When we feel supported, where we feel the presence of Christ, it's wonderful to feel that joy and for our giving to be a response to that, the joy of the Lord. It's very easy, friends, to be a church that's just marking time. You know what it means when you mark time? I don't know if you've ever been to a parade where the police are marching, or, you know, maybe the military is marching. When they mark time, it's when they have to stop. So someone lost their contact or something, you know, one of those dancers in the parade lost their contact and everybody has to stop. The police and the military people don't stop, they mark time. And you just stand there. Everybody's doing that in order because it's very hard to get started and very hard to get stopped. And I have to tell you, having done that for long periods of time, it is the worst kind of marching. It is a grind. It's the worst for blisters. You want to give your basic training class blisters? Guess what? To mark time for 10 minutes. That's what's going to happen is they're going to get those. It is just a grind. You want to be going somewhere. You want to be doing something. It's ultimately harder to be a church that's just stopped and marking time and going through the motions. That kind of church is just a grind. We want to be marked by the biblical marks of ministry, dynamic, engaged, and Christ-centered. And verses 46 to 47 make the point to show what's going on in the people's hearts. Again, friends, what a sense of joy in being a part of what this new thing that God is doing. There is nothing more energizing or motivating than being engaged in active spirit-led ministries. And let's be honest, okay? Want to be honest. We don't want to hide the hard stuff. Life together can sometimes be difficult. Where two or three are gathered, disagreements are going to happen. The Bible doesn't say that. I'm saying that because out of experience. There's big ups and downs in the church in Acts that we're going to see happen, even between apostles not agreeing with each other and splitting up and doing ministry in different areas. But in a Christ-centered church, challenges are met with hearts that are encouraged by the Lord, by the Holy Spirit in our midst, moving us in dynamic ways, because Jesus is bigger than any disagreement you or I might have. So our response. Now, I preached a couple weeks ago on the Holy Spirit. Do we really want to invite the Holy Spirit into our midst? Because the Holy Spirit has a tendency to do new things, has a tendency to blow the doors off places. So we're praying for the Holy Spirit, but we're doing so knowing what's going to happen. So I preached that, and I said, don't worry, there's nothing up my sleeve. We don't have plans for change. Do we just know the Lord has a tendency to do that? Well, this week, what isn't going to change? What doesn't change? I want you to invite you to look at this list. These things don't change. From the beginning, we teach the gospel. We fellowship together. We have the breaking of bread where we worship and we eat together and we pray together. And I want you to look at that list, friends. Maybe one of those things is speaking to you now. This is how the Lord wants to engage with you through this community. And that's something that you can be involved with a little more, getting involved with one of our study groups, maybe inviting someone from the church over, or going out to coffee together and breaking bread together. Or maybe it's just praying with somebody or coming out to our kingdom prayer time. So I just invite you to look at that, because if we start doing more of that, we start doing more of church. And when we start doing more of church with Jesus at the center, amazing things happen. And we see these over and over in Scripture. These are essential acts of aspects. Now, friends, the church can do more than this, right? We see there'll be more marks added as we go along, you know, like mission, things like that. But the church certainly can't do less than this. As we get back to normal worship life, what is God calling you to? Jesus speaks to his people through these means, and he uses them to form us into his own image. So it's an invitation to join the fellowship of the king. You know the fellowship of the ring? They storm Mordor with nothing but a few hobbits? Well, we're storming the gates here, and all you got is us. But we have the king. We're the fellowship of the king. Both as participants, I invite you to join, but also as leaders. And so our big finish, take us to our next slide. Yeah, I think I'll do it. I think I've got time. I want to end. They say, don't make the sermon about yourself. And I like to break rules, so I'm going to make the sermon about myself just for a second. I want to end with a thank you, okay? And kind of use myself as an example here. I was wandering around, ruminating on God's word, literally walking around in here, just kind of praying and thinking about God's word. And it hit me. Something hit me. You employ me to spend a large part of my week studying God's word. I don't know if you realize how awesome that is and how thankful I am for that. I'm just so appreciative. Amy and I both are to have been chosen and given the privilege of opening God's word every week. I'm just so very thankful. And it speaks to this. When you find your place in the community of faith, it is such a beautiful and life-giving thing. So you have helped to bring a beautiful life-giving thing into our lives. You are a beautiful and life-giving thing to us. And we're just so very thankful. I want to invite you, find your place. Find your place. And let's continue to build the community of formation to the likeness of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who paid it all. Let's pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks for your church, Lord God. It can be hard at times. We all know there can be disputes. But we pray, Lord God, that we would be a community that overcomes. We'd be a community that remembers where our citizenship is. And we would be a community that makes it all about you, Jesus. And the people said, amen. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up, and then we're going to break the bread together, as God's word says.
Let's stand together.
Oh,
To come forward. Everybody has their communion cup with you and your bread. So what we're going to do is I'm going to read a portion of scripture, then Brian's going to pray, and then we're going to take the bread together. And then Gary's going to pray, and then we're going to take the wine, quote-unquote, together. And we just remember at this time that as West Guilford Baptist Church, we place at the center of our worship the death and resurrection of our Lord. That is what has brought us life. His debt paid our ransom. And for that, we are eternally grateful. I offer to you the words of Paul from 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I first delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the night when he was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever, therefore, eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. So let a person examine himself or herself, and then so eat the bread and drink the cup." So I'm going to give us a moment to examine ourselves and offer ourselves to the Lord who loves and forgives us. And offer anything that we need to say sorry for. Whatever it is, friends, Jesus died and rose again to forgive you of it. Receive that forgiveness. I invite Brian to pray.
Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to come to your table in freedom. We don't have to worry about somebody coming in after us. Lord, we don't look at the cross. We look at your resurrection because we know you aren't on the cross anymore. You died with a broken body, blood streaming all over, Lord. And we just give thanks for that, Lord, that you accepted us as your children and our sheep of the Lamb. Lord, we just ask your blessings upon this element, the bread, which represents your broken body. With that, we ask this all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
If you're like me, things can kind of go awry. Christ's body broken for us. Amen. By Gary.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for us, Lord. He shed his blood for our sins, that we don't have to sacrifice. All we have to do is give our life to you, Lord Jesus, and his blood has made us clean, white as snow, Lord. We just thank you for this. This is last hymn we just sang together. It says it all, Lord. We just can't thank you enough. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Christ's blood shed for us. Amen. Invite the worship team to come back up.
Let's stand one last time together and sing Jesus Paid It All. Altar, Lord God, the real bread of the altar of the Lord's table, Jesus Christ, and for all he's paid for us, Lord God, in this signifying act, we participate in that in the same way, Lord God, that we participate and receive from you righteousness. We are so thankful, Lord God. And so we give you the benediction now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we can ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And the people said, Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everyone. God bless.